Welcome back. This is episode 6 of my tutorial on, or my project, making these Dragonfly Menuki. It's been a little while, but lots happened in between. We're back again. So today I'm going to mount the copper mounds that we made in the previous episode. We're going to talk about the pitch, handling the pitch, and the need for speed in the initial stages. These are the tools I'm going to be using, mainly these larger ones. You'll see how I use them. As I come to use a tool, I'll try to show you which one I'm using. I don't want to stop the process while I'm working, but I'll try to make it so that you can see what I'm doing. The two final ones, I'll be using them to start to define little gaps and cavities. You need to start from the very beginning to keep defining those. So that's what I'll be working with. So when doing uchidashi, it's always important to have a wet flannel to hand. When you place it, like I'll be doing in a moment, I'll be putting the copper into the pitch. The pitch will be really soft. So what I'll do is I'll pop the wet flannel, the damp flannel, on top of the copper. That'll draw the heat out of the surface. Of course, it won't take the heat out of the center of the pitch, but it'll enable me to work very quickly on the outside when it's relatively firm. Just as a point, you probably don't need to be told, wet damp cloths on steel tools is never a good idea, so keep them in a little plastic tub nearby. Now normally I warm up the copper, but because this is so soft and so hot, I think I can get away with putting this directly on the pitch like that, and the heat will travel through the copper, and this pitch will very, very clearly stick. I can feel it coming through, it's getting quite hot there. In the back of my power, just to squeeze it down, and then pulling all the pitch away. Pitch over the edge of the copper doesn't help, it doesn't hold it at all, it'll just chip off. You really don't want the pitch sliding over onto the work surface, because that just ends up with a messy, very amateurish looking piece of work. And I will mock you. Wet cloth on the piece just to take the heat out of the surface. Feel this pitch around here, I can pull it away still. You really don't want the piece to sink in at all. And this is a process that does require a certain degree of confidence. You can't hang around too much. Right, that's quite firm. I need to move quickly now. So taking my big flat punch, I'm going to go around the outside and seat it. Really giving it quite a firm tap all the way around. Don't be scared of it. Right, that's that. Now taking a much more rounded punch, like a bread loaf, a soft profile. Coming in from the sides. I need to turn it so I can see the edge, and coming at the bottom and scooping it up. So it's a scooping motion, starting from the bottom and coming up. It's a bit like making a sandcastle at the beach, gathering up the sand. Important to move quickly while the pitch is still relatively soft. Oh, it's come loose. Obviously, still very soft. So I'm going to warm it up again. Warming up the copper just on the, to be on the safe side this time. So I've just outlined that with bite mark pen so that I can see it a little bit more clearly, because obviously with filming we've got quite a lot of light on, so at times I really can't see, and also I'm trying to stay out of positions that might necessarily be necessary for me to see more clearly, so I need that as a guidance. You can do this yourself, it's not always necessary, but of course it is important, as I've said before, to just see what you're doing. Sacrifices I make for you. Right, so this area here, there's quite a lot of material here that doesn't all need to be pushed. If I started here, pushing up all of this material, we'd have quite a big ridge here. So, although I'm going to start here, I'm going to try and work the metal to the point where I know that once I come in vertical, I'll have the height I want over here, on this top edge. But it's a matter of managing this area here and imagining where the metal's got to go. So if we just started here and kept pushing up, we'd end up with far too much over here. So I'm going to start, and hopefully you'll be able to see how I adjust my approach. And with long forms, it's very important not to not to forget the ends. You really do need to bring these in, because as you get an object narrower, both sides, you end up with a bit over here that you've somehow got to push back in. So this work, and particularly this area here, needs to start right now. So on this side, I'm quite confident if I just keep working from here, I'll have all the height I want. But if I'm working from this side where there's a load of material to move, it would end up far too high. So when I displace all of this, if I do it from here, I push all of this in, you can imagine all of that volume's got to go up somewhere. So I'm going to come in a more gradual place, whereas here I'm coming more vertically. And it's really important to pay particular attention to the ends of objects. You really don't want the end of the object, like in this case a dragonfly, for those wings to drop off unnaturally. I really want them to be a nice flat plane, and I'm controlling the form as I'm pulling it in. You can see I'm moving at a much more gradual pace. The slope, I mean, is much more gradual as opposed to here, it was much more severe. It's inevitable this is going to happen quite a lot, especially in the beginning stages. You're putting quite a lot of force into the piece and it's going to come loose, pop out, but that's fine. Just warm it up again. We've still got a lot more moving to do before we need to anneal, so we can crack on. Right, so I've reseated the piece, warmed up the pitch. What I did while it was still quite warm, I went around with the big flat punch again, and I push these edges down again, because obviously as I'm working here, there's quite a lot of pressure going down, so it's creating, making these edges sort of curl up, which is not helpful, because what happens then is you're actually not getting a full scoop every time, you're not sort of getting in. So I took the opportunity, of course, to go around and just seat it once more. And this is something to really keep an eye on. You constantly want to be making sure that you've got full access to the piece. You don't want to be working in a swimming pool or in a dip. Okay, so it's still quite soft. I don't want to start belting it too much right now. So the issue you're dealing with right now is you need the pitch to be malleable enough, soft enough, so that when you're working the copper, it really can move, but at the same time, it needs to be hard enough to hold the piece in place. It really does need that balance to be just right. And it's just a matter of experience. You'll learn how much you can push the thing around. And as you've seen so far, it does pop off, and you've got to simply put it back and carry on. It needn't be a big disaster. The trick is to not be too hesitant, and really be quite courageous in pushing the metal around. Now, I've got to get in this little groove here, so I need to start preparing for that. Now, I did it like this. Use a smaller punch. If you're careful with those sharp edges, just want to, I've got to define more than anything else. Really important to avoid sharp edges catching the metal, because once you do that, that's a weak spot. But at some point, it's going to fail, and you'll have a hole in your piece, and your whole world will fall apart. There are, of course, ways to repair tears in your metal. If you send me $50, I will send you instructions on how to do that. Here I'm practically pushing the metal down because I've got quite a lot of material, so I'm going for a straight line here, not scooping so much. I'm just bringing the line up just close to the outline of the design. I'm pushing this metal down directly. This is not your usual practice, but as I say, I've got way too much material here. So I need to manage it and push it back a bit. Staying away from the edge of the design. A couple of millimeters is adequate. Right, now I can come back in here. So what you can see happening here, along the edge here, is the pitch is tearing. So much force on this whole body of pitch, and though it's firming up and it's still hanging on, it's all being pulled across. It's still quite pliable, but the body of the pitch is probably still a little bit hard. As we work, of course, the pitch will get warmer and warmer. This kind of thing is less likely to happen. Also, you're subjecting the piece to less impact. While the piece is still hard, firm, I can now do a little bit of defining here. One thing I would point out is, as you can see, I've done quite a lot of work and I've really defined the form quite strongly, and we haven't annealed it yet. One of the hesitations, I think, in novices' work is that there's the tendency to anneal too frequently. And so for the process then is drawn out unnecessarily. You can do quite a lot of work in one pass. And in fact, your average Menuki, you could probably completely form in about three to four anneals at most. So bear that in mind, you can push the metal a lot further than you probably think. If it's really resisting movement, it probably means your pitch has got hard and you've been a bit slow and you've been dawdling. So, you've got to be fairly courageous and learn the limits of the metal and work fairly quickly. I've let the piece sit for a few minutes. So now the pitch has firmed up quite a lot. I'm not going to be able to move much at all. I think I'm pretty much done with this first phase of moving the metal. But before I take it out and anneal it, I'm going to use a tracing tool, a lining tool, like that. It's a very soft profile. And I'm just going to outline these lines. Not the outer lines, because those we come to when we're working up, when we define it that way. But these lines need to be defined at this point, so that in the next stage, when I'm bringing up here, this area needs to come down because that plane is on top of this one. Similarly, that is on is underneath this, and that part there obviously goes under that wing. And also I need to define the body over here and make a separation between that wing and the tail. I'm not trying to do this too hard, not too deep. I don't want to create a situation where I've got a weakened or thinned area here. I'm just separating these two areas. This area, there's some tiny little wrinkles in the finished piece. It's no point me trying to define that at this point, so I'll just have a general line. I can put in those tiny details later. At this stage, I'm more concerned with the general planes, the general areas being worked out. I'm going to use a little flat punch, this little flat punch here, to separate this area here. A little bit too big, something a little finer. This little rectangular one might give me a bit more control. Getting in here. I'm pushing the body in away from the wings. It's got to happen, so that will happen now. I'm
eyes. It must be separated a little bit. Yeah. It's just that little area over here, kind of fine.
So I want to talk about defining the planes while I'm trying to separating areas. I'm trying to create a situation right now at the beginning where I understand that that piece is a separate element from this. It's not just an overall shaped form that's got a line to it. They must appear to be separate pieces. So separating the elements of your design is really important to make the shape look convincing. And also, it needs to start right from the very beginning. So this is the first step. That's step one in this process. I'm going to stop there. I'm going to take it out now. I'll anneal it, and I'll speak a little bit about annealing afterwards. I'm not going to film that. You've seen annealing before. It's just be superfluous at this point. Right, so the piece has been annealed and pickled, nice and clean. You can see the inside. There's no marking on the inside of a piece of which Uchidashi worked typically. It was a mark of pride not to have to resort to going back on the inside once work started. Right, so what we've got here is, I want to show you that kind of profile I'm going for. You can see the mountain I'm trying to achieve, nice defined edges. This edge, of course, is a little bit more defined along here. This one is a little bit more sloped, as you saw me coming more gently. And of course I've started to define the planes of the wings and the body and the tail. I've drawn in the pattern again. So what we've got here is the plate is distorted again. We're ending up with a little bit of a what are we calling it? A boat shape, I don't know. So what I'm going to do is I could put it on the side of a piece of wood, whatever, but I'm going to use my bench block, it's just a hand, and a wooden mallet, and I'm going to just tap along here, okay, and some wings, okay for now. So when I put it in pitch, of course, I'll push down the edges again, and we're good to go. What you can see now is that the form is becoming quite defined. The next step, I shall be going in and bringing these sides in, and I want the punch work to stop on the line that defines the form. So that's the goal of this step. Also, I'll be defining these planes more clearly, so I've got some nice steps between these two and separating the body a little bit more and bringing in this area. So just to repeat, I'll be bringing in this area, bringing it in, going more for the vertical and defining this edge. Similarly over here, quite a lot of work to be done here. And I shall be bringing in, working, but this time bringing it right up to that line. So there's a worked line that's defined then on this edge. And then separating these planes further and working in here. Right, so I put it back in. The pitch has been allowed to cool a little bit under the wet flour, and I've been around the outside, seated it nicely. The other thing I should mention is this is still quite hot, so you really have to be quite ginger about it. So I'm going to go in on the end using my all-purpose teardrop tool and work in these two little areas right at the start while it's still nice and cold. Let's be careful now, this is a small tool and I don't want to create too much of a problem, so I'm going to just gently massage the metal
into place while it's still nice and soft. Oh, it is quite hot on my fingers. Big and tall. A round punch. Round punch at this point just to gather in some air. Now I must be careful not to do too much here because I need to bring this in as well here. If I only concentrate on here, I'll end up with a piece stuck out that will fold back on itself. And you don't want things folding back on themselves. And come back in here. And chase this metal in. Sort of gathering metal from here and bringing it forward, bringing it forward. You don't want to concentrate on the tip because that's a surefire way to cut through the metal. I've worked here quite extensively, I've pushed in quite strongly. So what happens there is you get these areas, this area for instance, rounding too much. So it's really important at this stage I flatten that. Otherwise, as I push in, that's simply going to bulge up and cause this to bulge. So if I flatten this, it actually provides a resistance to this ball here. In fact, I shouldn't be doing much more work on this until the rest is much more defined. But the next job here is to define this and set up some kind of resistance to the front. So use the finer punch, sharper edged, to just start the line, and then I was able to use a softer flatter to go in there and just push the metal down as I need it. And I shall do the same here. Overlapping the strokes, so one go in the next little bit, a bit like raising really, and I'm just bringing the work face just up to that line, just stopping short. There. You'll notice the area I'm working is relatively smooth because I'm overlapping the blows very carefully. So I'm working the whole sheet as one
piece, really. I'm trying to avoid individual areas being overworked overly much, so that the whole sheet moves together and spreads the strain. I'm using it round because I really don't want to cause any thinning at the bottom. So I'm trying again to spread the strain. That's the sort of soft profile there. Down there, because I've seen too much metal coming up here in this little slot. Put enough height there, I just push the metal in. And this is where you have to start thinking carefully about what you're doing. There's a point at which you have to take stock of what you've achieved and where you need to go next in terms of moving metal. So here, the big job is this separation of the tail from the wing. Just got to figure out how Unno Shomin did it. On the top edge of this vertical side, if we are chasing the material up to the outline of the design, up to the drawn marker pen line. What that does is it firms that metal up, so when I work the side again here, this top edge is firm and hopefully the whole wall will move up together, giving me that last bit of height I need. This height here, the tip of the wing there to there, that is my, at this point, theoretical height of the end of the Menuki. In fact, when it's finished, I probably only need two-thirds of that material. So even though this is sloping off, I'm not overly concerned because I do have adequate height. I can now bring this whole plane here level. So that wing is one piece. But I need to study the original in a little while to really get the nuance of the form properly understood. I think that's about as far as I'm going to go for now. I'm going to do a lot more study of the original piece now, and I'll come back and start setting in planes and defining the form further. It doesn't need to be annealed right now. There's a fair bit of work I can still do, as it's not a significant amount of material I'm going to be moving. It's more a matter of defining planes and so forth. This metal, the untouched metal, of course, is still soft. So that's where we are now. Fairly quick process in all, I think you'll be able to see.